because I've just realised I've not actually put my mic on this morning. 2 seconds, talk amongst yourselves. I mean, not that I've not got a loud enough voice that I probably don't need it anyway, but never mind. Can I tell you, it's been a week and a half of things that I have forgotten or that have gone wrong. Yesterday, on a Saturday, I like to check the service and I pulled it up. Oops, I forgot to say that there's no sermon. Now, I'm fairly sure that most of you in here would be going, results! However, I'd get a row, so sorry, I've rewritten it. You're getting a sermon this morning. I heard that. But welcome to worship here this morning, where God has promised to love us despite the mistakes that we make. Everyone is welcome in here in this house of God, whether you're here for the first time or you are visiting us today for the first. Everyone online, hello, you're all welcome too. Couple of intimations. Thought I'd lost my bit of paper there. Told you, it's been a week. So, many thanks, first of all, to everybody who has knitted and hand-crocheted poppies. Could we have them returned by Sunday, the 29th of October? There is now a box at the back door, if you can put any completed ones in it. It's just so that we know how many we've got and how many I might have to crochet. And as I don't really have a lot of time, I'm hoping that you guys will do it for me. Thank you very much. Art and Soul Creative Christianity, there is a meeting for that this morning after the service in the session room. But go and get your cup of tea and a biscuit and then take it in with you. Don't want you missing out on that biscuit that we'll give you. It'll only last about 15 minutes, apparently, I've been told. Okay, so there will be a pop-up table after the service in the hall today. I've seen it. Now, I'm not going to get in straight after church, so please leave me something, because I've seen all the sweet treats and it looks amazing. Sweet Treats Autumn Delights, and it's running in conjunction with Cafe Church's pop-up table during October. And just a little plug for Cafe Church. We welcome everyone to Cafe Church on a Wednesday. For the usual, there's home baking and a cuppa, there's fellowship, I do a wee bit of worship. Sometimes we have some singing. It's not me, because I'm rubbish. A wee bit of reflection. But enjoy the fellowship. Have some lunch and just have some conversation with folk that you do like. Please come. Join us every Wednesday, 11 till 1 in the hall. Everybody is very, very welcome. Couple of wee celebratory ones this morning. Marion Brown, who is the wife of an old session clerk here, is 90 on Wednesday. So I think we should all say happy birthday. After three, shout happy birthday. 1, 2, 3. Happy birthday! And wee Anna from Children's Church. How's this for you? She's not here this morning because she's running in a, I think it's a 1K mucky run. Now, I don't know whether we want to congratulate her for doing it or wish luck to Laura, because she's going to have to wash whatever she's wearing. Because I remember when my daughter did my Tough Mudder. Let's just say it all went in the bin. Nothing went in the washing. So that is this morning, a few wee intimations. But this morning we are here, of course, not just to worship God, but to dedicate the boys and the officers of our BB company. You're very welcome in here, as are your family and friends and those who have come to support you. I hope you enjoy the service, and there may be a wee sweetie or two, because they've got to know, I do like a wee sweetie now. Our call to worship. We come, trusting in God's mercy and grace, longing to know and to learn more about God's ways. We come to be guided in the ways of God's truth, to experience the joy of God's salvation. We come aware of God's steadfast love, anchoring us through every trial and tribulation. We come to dedicate our lives anew, safe in the promise of God's everlasting love. Amen. If you are able, will you please stand as we sing together our opening hymn of worship, hymn 458, At the Name of Jesus. Eternal and sovereign God, with awe and wonder we come to worship you, to declare your praises and offer our homage. You are all-powerful, all-seeing, ever-present, shaping the pattern of history, at work in your church, involved in all our lives. You are all-good, all-loving, ever merciful, showering us with your blessings, reaching out in our need, forgiving our faults and restoring us to your side. You are always true, always faithful, ever constant, challenging us to do what is right, standing by us when we go wrong, daily fulfilling your promises with constant dependability. You are all holy, all pure, ever perfect, acting in ways beyond our understanding, cleansing us from our imperfections, just and righteous in all you do. Forgive us for the times we have not worshipped you as we should, that we have not praised you with heart and soul and mind, that we have glimpsed so little of your greatness. Forgive us for failing to appreciate your mercy, your steadfastness, and for losing our awe and wonder before you. Open our eyes afresh to your splendor, our hearts to your love, our minds to your purpose, and our spirits to your presence. As we remember the promises that you have made and kept, hear us now as we pray together the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever. Amen. Well, as it was the 140th birthday on the 4th of October, so just Wednesday there, of the Boys Brigade, I thought we'd have a wee quiz, because you know I do like a quiz, right? And well, let's see how much the boys and officers actually know about the organisation that they're a part of. What do we reckon? Do we reckon the boys will know more than the officers?
Yes.
No? Oh, I've got a few officers shaking their head. So, there are sweets. So whoever gets one right might get a sweet, right? As long as Harry doesn't eat them all before we get there. Okay, now the first one is really, really easy. What does BB stand for? Yes? Smashing. Come and get a sweet. In fact, you know what? Lauren. Oh no, because you're in a bit of pain. Are you sure? You sit. There you go. It's got to be useful for something. Okay, how many. How many sections are in the BB? And what are they? Yes?
There's
four sections and there's an anchor, junior. Uh-huh. So that was right. Four anchors, juniors, company, seniors. Okay. If you don't get this right, I might have to. That would just prove that nobody was listening to me. How many years old is the BB? Let's have someone who's not answered. Yep. 140, give that boy a sweet. Right. Boys might not get this one. If the officers don't get this one, I think we need to sack them all. Who founded? No, that doesn't mean you get it wrong on purpose. You never saw that. Who founded the BB? Go on, Matthew. What was that? Perfect. William Alexander Smith. And see, look, anybody has a sweetie that wants one coming in here. Okay. Don't know that any of you will get this. Where? Oh, no, sorry. What was the name of the first company formed? Anybody other than Matthew? Yes? The first Glasgow, there you go. That's it, you're not getting sacked now, sorry. Okay, where did the first company meet? That's a hard one. Oh, two of them know it. Matthew. It's not quite the answer I've got here. What were you going to say? Well, it was actually the Free Church Mission Hall on North Woodside Road. To be precise. But they can have a sweet. But I think as they've already had a sweet, we should maybe give it to the two boys that are sitting beside them. I don't want to be seen to be encouraging like diabetes or anything, you know what I mean? Okay. Right. They should all Everybody should get this one. In fact, some of the congregation should get this one. Who is the captain of the Second Canvas Nephin Company? Oh, right, who's not answered? You've all answered. You answered? Right, Robbie? Is it Mr. Lanigan? Do we think that's right?
Yes.
Of course it is. Okay. If they'd got that wrong, I think there would have been trouble. I think we'd have had to have done a history lesson. Okay. What is the BB motto? Yes. It is sure and steadfast. No, that's the hymn goes. That's how the hymn goes. Ah, see, we've got debate over here about, is that the right order? No, steadfast and sure as the billows roll. Aye, the motto's sure and steadfast, but the hymns. Aye, that's what we're talking about. Honest. Okay. What is the highest award in the BB? Yes. Queen's badge. It's not quite been renamed yet, has it?
It's in the works.
It's in the works. It will be the King's badge, but we're not quite. Okay, last one. And if you're not sure, just look at your jumpers. What colours are on the BB crest? Throw it at. Who's not answered? No? Okay, just anybody tell me then. Yep. Robbie? Red. Well, it's red and gold, but we'll go for yellow. That's right. It's the anchor. Okay. Hands up if you're in the BB and you've not had a sweetie. Because I'm really nice and I'll give you all a sweetie. You can have one as well. While the sweets are going out. Later on in the service, everyone here, not just the boys and the officers, but everyone in here will make some promises. Some promises to support and encourage the boys and officers of our BB company. They will make promises to uphold the life values of the BB that they serve. But did you know that there are approximately 8,810 promises in the entire Bible? Hands up if you knew that. Good, glad to see you're not fibbers. In the Old Testament, there's approximately 7,706. And in the New Testament, 1,104 wonderful promises. Deuteronomy itself, in fact, Deuteronomy chapter 28, has 133 promises in that one chapter, more than any other chapter in the Bible. Our readings this morning that will be brought to us by the BB talk of just two of those promises. The promises made to Noah and the promises made to Abraham. But people make promises every single day. Hands up if you have made a promise ever in your life. Hands up if when you were a child, and you are still children, so you can think back probably last week where you promised that you would keep your room tidy. Hands up if you broke that promise. Promises are really easy to make, but they're also really easy to break. And sometimes we give a promise to someone or another person, or we sign things as a symbol of that promise. Or a wedding ring is a symbol of a promise to love, cherish, and we're not going to say obey, but love each other through the good times and the hard times. It's a seal of our promise. Other times though, we just say to someone, I give you my word, I'm going to do it. They say, so when people get married, they say, I love you for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, as long as we both shall live. These days though, it's a promise that sometimes seems to be taken and not kept. But people make promises every single day. Do we always keep them? No, we don't. But God makes promises too. God makes promises to us 8,000 times in the Bible. And does he keep those promises? What do you think? We've got some nodding heads. Of course he does. God will never make a promise to us that he will break. He does whatever he promises. We could learn from that. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for always keeping your promises to us. Your promise to always love us, to always be there for us through the storms of life. Help us to keep the promises we make to other people, to not break trust, and to follow in your example. Amen. If you're able, will you please stand as we sing together hymn 143, Who Put the Colours in the Rainbow? Taken from Hebrews and Genesis, and our BB will be bringing those readings to us. Yes?
When God made a promise to Abraham, because he had no one greater by whom to swear, he swore himself, saying, I surely bless you and multiply you. And thus Abraham, having patiently endured, obtained the promise. Humans, of course, swear by someone greater than themselves. And an oath given as confirmation puts an end to all despite among them. In the same way, when God desired to show even more clearly to the heirs of promise the unchangeable character of his promise, he granted it by oath, so that through two unchangeable things in which it is possible that God would prove, it is impossible that God would have proved false. He who have taken refuge and be strongly encouraged to seize the hope set before us. We have this hope, a sure and steadfast anchor of the soul, a hope that enters the inner shrine behind the curtain, where Jesus, the forerunner on our behalf, has entered, having become a high priest forever according to the order of Melchizedek.
Then God said to Noah and to his sons with him, "As for me, I am establishing my covenant with you and your descendants after you, and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the domestic animals, and every animal of the earth with you. As many as came out of the ark, I establish my covenant with you that will never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of a flood. And never again shall there be a flood to destroy earth." God said, "This is the sign of the covenant that I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for all future generations. I have set my bow in the clouds, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring clouds over the earth, and the bow is seen in the clouds, I will remember my covenant that is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh. And the waters shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh. When the bow is in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of flesh that is on earth. God said to Noah, "This is the sign of the covenant that I have established between me and all the flesh that is on earth."
Amen, and thanks be to God for these, his words. Thank you to the boys for reading them, and I'm so sorry that you got that really, really dodgy word at the end. But well done. I do apologise for that. If you're able, will you please stand as we sing together Mission Praise 1039, Colours of Day, Dawn into the Land, Mind. This morning it was about the flood. I don't know how many of you have seen on social media the floods that have been happening across Glasgow and Inverclyde. In fact, at Bowling train station, the water's that high, it's up to the top of the platform, and that's on the tracks. My daughter lived through, when I say lived through, they had a great laugh canoeing in the floods in Carlisle a few years ago. And I've got folk out canoeing in Glasgow. Yeah, well, knowing Glasgow city streets and how dirty they are, I don't know that I'd be out doing that. But anyway, I found a little book this week, and it's called Gone Yourself, Moses. It says it's a light-hearted trip through the Old Testament in Glaswegian verse. I know, I vetted it first. But I thought I'd share a little bit about what it says that we heard read properly this morning. God said, "Just do as I say." But Noah wasn't keen. "Do you not just think the thing might sink and be a submarine?" God answered, "Trust me, Noah. I'll never let you down. Just simply do as I tell you to, and I promise you'll not drown." Then Noah and his family saw a rainbow through the rain, The colours meant God's wrath was spent and man could start again. And yet we ken there's always be folk who'll go astray and seek reward without the Lord and gang their ain sweet way. But though man tries, he'll never find the gold at rainbow's end. For Noah showed salvation's road is just to be God's friend. It's a slightly different telling of the story. And it goes to show that it doesn't matter what language or dialect, for that matter, that the Bible is written in. It can speak to anyone and everyone. And one of the things about preparing for a service on a Sunday morning is how when I read the Bible verses that I'm going to preach on, I find that they can speak to a situation that we face in life, or in fact, the world that we face today. Our readings this morning are about promises, the promises made by God. And I wondered as I read and I wrote how they relate to our world today. So to quote, I can't believe I'm going to say this, Jesse J, everybody has a price, the sale comes first and the truth comes second. Or as Mary Poppins puts it, promises are like pie crusts, easily made and easily broken. I didn't think I'd ever quote Jesse J and Mary Poppins in the same sentence in a sermon, but well, there you go. But how do our readings this morning reflect our world? What does it say about those who lie when the truth doesn't quite measure up to their plans and ambitions for themselves? What does it say about those who make promises, knowing fine well that they'll never keep them? I think we could all think of one category of people who seem to do that day in, day out, and that would be our politicians. What does it say that those who are offering themselves to the highest calling in our country cannot keep a single promise? Of course, let's be honest, it's not as simple as differentiating between those who lie and those who don't. Those who make and break, or those who keep promises. And of course, it doesn't really matter anyway, does it? But it matters. And it matters because what these readings allude to is the issue of trust. Where do we place our trust? And in whom do we place our trust? In a fish and chip shop in St Andrews, there used to be a sign behind the till which read, "In God I trust." Everybody else pay cash. Trust is something that is very hard to earn, but it's very easy to lose it. Yet without trust, civilization and our way of life would break down entirely. Trust is the firm belief in the reliability, truth, or ability of someone or something. Each time we get in the car, unless you're my daughter, and for those of you who don't know and those of you who do know, my daughter has had so many issues with this car, it's unbelievable. In fact, she phoned me again this week to say, "My engine management light's coming on." She does not trust that car anymore. Every time you get on a bus or a plane, we trust that it'll take us from where we're wanting to go to where we need to be. Each time we speak to medical or legal or an accounting professional, we trust them to guide us and advise us for the best. So where does one safely put our trust? What is our true security? Does it come from accumulating the most money, the most stuff, or the most influence and power? No, sorry, it doesn't. When it comes to our faith, we place our trust in a God who waits for us, to take the courageous step forward into what sometimes can feel like the unknown, only to find that God is already there waiting for us. It's almost as if each day that we get out of our bedroom and put our foot on the surface of the floor, we step out with courage once more into a world that is filled with hope and fear, light and dark, peace and strife, but doing so in the knowledge that God is there. We can trust in God because God makes promises and keeps them. In Him we can put our anchor. The Hebrews passage that we heard this morning describes hope as an anchor of the soul. And the metaphor compares the Christian to a boat out on the sea of life. There are storms ahead. There are storms which threaten us from all sides. Persecution, adversity, doubt, death, and the list goes on. And just as the boat's anchor reaches down to the bottom of the ocean and out of sight, the Christian's anchor ascends out of sight into heaven, where it's there, fixed. To serve any purpose, an anchor must hold. It must be sure and steadfast. When sailors cast out an anchor, they want it to take hold on the bottom of the sea to prevent the boat from drifting, to keep them from being driven upon the rocks which might destroy their ship. The Christian's hope also must be that the anchor must hold. A Christian's hope is in that anchor, and it will give them stability in the midst of the storms of life. During the storms, the ship may drift a little bit, but the fixed anchor will always bring it back to its moorings. We can place our hope and our trust in God because God will always be there for us. And that's fine for our relationship with God. But what happens when people betray our trust and let us down? Christians live by faith in God, but we must also confront and not deny the costly reality of human hurt. Our call to be people who live pointed towards a horizon of hope doesn't give us license to neglect or ignore the very real pain inflicted by the unjust and the arrogant. Our place is to be the hope in justice that God spurs us on to redress. Nelson Mandela said that what counts in life is not the fact that we have lived, it is what difference we have made in the lives of others. Trust gives us strength and sustains life. Should that trust be broken, it hurts. In fact, it's devastating, and it can take time for us to move on and rebuild something that will never be the same, but we move on because of the trust and the hope that we have. But did you know that not only do we trust and hope in God, God hopes and trusts in us. When you look at the love and the sacrifice that God has done for us, has given us through Jesus, you better believe that you matter to God. God has placed trust in you. But for us, placing trust in God doesn't remove our responsibilities in life. A newly appointed minister went to visit the home of a congregation member. Upon arriving there, the minister discovered his host was an avid gardener. And the minister, was only too delighted to show the minister around his garden, a magnificent sea of greens and purples and blues and whites, yellows and pinks. Clearly it was spring and not the storms of autumn. Wanting to set the relationship off on a strong positive note, the minister said, "Isn't it wonderful that when we put our trust in the beauty of God's handiwork?" And his host replied, in a somewhat offended tone, "Now, minister, dinna be giving all the credit to God. You should have seen this garden when the Almighty had it to himself." The gardener, in fact, had a very good and sound theology. God has designed the world in such a way that God works with us, in partnership with us, and we with God to achieve his plans. Placing trust in God means working in partnership to address steadily or radically the many ills in the world, whether local, national, or international. Where do we place our hope and trust? In a God who will work alongside women and men across the world to stand up for justice, to stand against persecution, prejudice, and violence. It's not a problem that has to be addressed far away. On the 11th of July, on a train from Galashiels to Edinburgh, a man and his son were told, "Go back to your own country. There is prejudice in this country. And if we want to live in a world of freedom and equality, we must work at building a society founded on hope and trust that will survive the knocks that it will undoubtedly receive, and be something that we, by the way that we live and speak and act, will show what and who we value and work towards. But what gives people of faith confidence to rise each day is a strong trust in a God of kindness, truthfulness, justice, and hope, who stands beside us and has promised to always stand beside us. One who has promised to be the anchor for our soul and who will never break that promise. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. If you are able, will you please stand as we sing together hymn 557. And this is one from our Songs of Praise list that never quite made the top 10. So, O love that wilt not wait for.
Oh,
The object of the Boys' Brigade is the advancement of Christ's kingdom among boys and the promotion of the habits of obedience, reverence, discipline, self-respect, and all that tends towards true Christian manliness. We as a congregation fully support both the object of the Boys' Brigade, and we pray that in all the activities of the second Campus Nethin, our children will gain a sense of adventure for life, learning to respect both themselves and others, and gain a sense of faith that will guide and lead them through childhood and teenage years into the maturity of adulthood, continuing to grow in the faith of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Saviour. Today, the leaders and boys of our company have come to pledge themselves afresh to this work. Let us therefore commit them to Christ as we pray together. We thank you, Lord, that in every generation you entrust young people to the care of your church and call those who are to exercise a ministry among them. Grant that by the power of the Holy Spirit, those who pledge themselves afresh to this service today may be enabled to fulfill this task through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Can I ask our company captain and officers in charge to please stand? Officers of the 2nd Campus Nethin Company of the Boys' Brigade, you have been called by God to the work of caring and training the boys of our company. Will you, by your work and example, seek to advance Christ's kingdom and work in partnership with the church to share the gospel of Jesus Christ? May God give you the grace to be faithful to him and successful in your work for him in the Boys' Brigade. Please be seated. Can I now ask our other officers, leaders and helpers to please stand? Officers, leaders and helpers of the 2nd Campus Nethin Company of the Boys' Brigade, your captain has shown faith and confidence in you. Do you now promise, with God's help, to support your captain and officers in charge loyally, to carry out your duties cheerfully and at all times to set a good example to all other members and boys of the company? May God help you to keep your promise and play your part in the service of others. And now we re-enroll the whole company and ask the boys to stand. As members of the Boys' Brigade, you are part of the worldwide family of the church. Do you promise to be a loyal member of the Boys' Brigade and to support the activities of the company? May God help you to keep your promise and give you the strength to overcome temptation and be loyal to our great captain and saviour, Jesus Christ. Finally, can I ask the congregation to stand? I have a question for you. Do you promise to support the work of our company of the Boys' Brigade and to pray for its leaders and boys, that God will keep them sure and steadfast in their faith?
Amen. Amen.
Thank you. Let us then pray for our Boys' Brigade company and follow that with our prayers for those known and unknown to us. Let us pray. God of love and promises, you give each of us special gifts and skills. And today we celebrate your call on those who serve you by leading and being examples to the boys in their care. We give you our past, with its joys, sadness, and mistakes. Our present with its celebrations, difficulties, hopes, and fears. Our future with its pain and promise of what is ahead. Trusting the hand that made the world, trusting the spirit that breathes life, trusting the love that will not let us go. We thank you that you will give us all we need and that we can always trust in you to lead us in our faith discovery. We thank you that through our wondering and exploring of the stories of faith, we can, as a church, grow in your love. Generous God, through your Son, Jesus Christ, you have shown to us what it means to love, and you call us to follow your example, to love our neighbours as we love ourselves. Continue to write your law of love on our hearts. Give us an unwavering passion for justice and a tenacious faith that will not rest until the hungry are fed, the oppressed find relief, and the outsider finds a welcome. Everlasting God, we wait, we watch, we long for you. Renew our powers, refresh our spirits, restore our well-being, for you give new strength to the faint and power to the powerless. May your church be found working among those who lack resources or rights. May we seek to care for those who cannot care for themselves. We pray for the lowly and the humiliated. We pray for relief organisations. Be to them a tower of strength. We pray for the great powers of the world, the strong nations and mighty governments. May their power be used properly and the poor protected, the weak not exploited, and no one oppressed. We pray too for multinational corporations who often wield more power than many governments, that in their relentless pursuit of profit, they may take those steps of compassion and concern which will benefit them as well as those powerless to stop them. We give thanks for all who have cared for us in times of weakness, for those who have uplifted our spirits and given us new hope. We pray for our friends and families, especially those who are finding life difficult. We pray for any in our community that feel neglected or rejected. We pray for all who are in weakness of body, mind, or spirit, all those who have come to the end of their tether. We think of all those who are losing their mobility or agility, those who are losing their memories, of those who no longer trust in anyone, those who doubt the love of God. And we pray for all who are caring for loved ones at this time. May your blessing be upon those called and those prayed for, and may we encourage and support them through our prayers and our practices. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. If you are able, will you please stand as we sing the BB hymn, hymn 737, Will Your Anchor Hold.
Thank you.
standing for the national anthem. Go now with confidence, for the Lord is with you. May the joy of Christ shine in your eyes. The compassion of Christ reach out through your hands. The word of Christ fall from your mouth. The peace of Christ fill your mind. And the love of Christ flow from your heart. And the blessings of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be among us and remain with us, now and forever.